Yes, you can start.
Okay, perfect. So, good morning, everyone. My name is Tim Favier. I'm from Utrecht University in the Netherlands. I'm a teacher trainer. My students will become the geography teachers of the future. And I'm doing some research too. And this presentation will be about young people in the Netherlands, what they think and feel about climate change. So it connects to the presentation of Tomasz, but it focuses more at a specific age group, the kids, 14 or 15 year old kids. And the presentation will be about how kids in the Netherlands will think about climate change, but I also will tell something about other countries and how we can use this in education. Let's see. We'll start with her. You all know her, right? She's been advocating that we should do something about climate change. And she shows a lot of involvement in climate change. And last year, there were climate change strikes in many schools in Europe and other countries. And this also raises some questions about these kids. What do they think about climate change? Are they really sincere, or do they just think it's like a day out? Is everyone suffering of ecorexia, just like Greta? Or is that just a small group of young people? And what about the other kids who didn't go to the strikes? The kids at the play yard, the kids hanging out at school, are they not involved? Are they ignorant about climate change? Skeptic, maybe? Or just bluntly uninterested? Or maybe are they fatalistic, that they think we cannot do something about it, it's going to happen anyway? What do the average young people in the Netherlands think about climate change? So that will be the focus of this presentation. It's not my research, it's research by a colleague of me, and he works as a teacher trainer in Amsterdam. And Amsterdam, it's the biggest city in the Netherlands, but still it's not as big as Prague. He has been conducting surveys among 14 and 50 year olds, more than 3,000 surveys. And this is the age in the Netherlands, students have geography until the age of 15 years old. And after that, they can choose if they want geography as a graduation subject. And climate change has been taught to kids 12 to 15 years old, but it focuses mostly at the causes of climate change. My colleague, he has conducted surveys and also more depth interviews with these kids. And I will tell you something about his results. If you have any questions, please use the chat. And Jirka will read out the questions for me so I can answer them during the presentation. Feel free to interrupt. Also, if you want to use the microphone, please do so. So in the survey, there was this question also, which issues are the greatest threats to the world, to the Netherlands, and to yourself? Similar to the European Union research that Tomasz talked about. And now kids could choose between different kinds of threats. And one of these threats was climate change. And you could also see other threats that could be indirectly related to climate change. But the question was, what are the greatest threats to the world? And then you see that many kids, 36%, says that climate change is one of the two biggest threats to the future of the world. And then if you compare this for the future of the Netherlands, it's far less. And the future of themselves, it's even less than that. It's just 43%. And what is the biggest threat to the Netherlands? Then many kids say that it is migration. And biggest threats to themselves, still it is climate change, but it's almost the same as health issues. These surveys were conducted in the autumn of 2018, by the way, which is just after the long, dry, hot summer we had 2 years ago. So what do you see if you look at these data? My colleague, he also conducted some interviews, and then kids had to explain why they think that. And many kids say, well, I think we can already notice it, but it will be more something for other countries like Bangladesh, but not for the Netherlands and not for me. This is called psychological distancing. It's a bias that we think that severe effects are not going to happen to ourselves, but to other people. Then about doubt about climate change, and this question was asked, do you doubt whether climate change is really taking place on the left, and do you doubt if it's really caused by humans? So what do you see is that among kids, there's little skepticism. The skepticism is generally low. Most kids think that climate change is actually happening and it's actually caused by humans. A little doubt might not be a problem. But you can see that almost no kids agree. And do you worry about climate change? Then you can see that just a small part is not worried at all. And about a quarter is worried about climate change. And when compared to what they think, how their parents feel about climate change, then you can see that kids are more worried about climate change than their parents. And this was also in the European Union research that you can see that the age has an effect on the perception of climate change. Young people are more worried about climate change than their parents. But still, there are some kids that are just not worried at all. Then about the impact, what impact do you see for the future of the Netherlands? And then you can see that many kids think that it will have some impact in the Netherlands, but still there are some that are neutral this is agreed, it should be agreed. It should be agreed. But most agree that it will have some impact. And does it impact themselves in the future? Most are neutral. This is again this psychological distancing. Yeah. Well, and here you can see a quote of a student. For me personally, it doesn't matter. It's more for Bangladesh. They have floods there. I haven't seen it here. And this quote is also includes another aspect, another bias. Another student said this: I was thinking about the ice sheets, but does it really affect me? When I walk on the streets, I do not see climate change. Or maybe when it's warm, but then I do not think about climate change. So on the quote on the left, you can see a bias. It's called optimism bias. It hasn't happened to me yet, so I cannot imagine that it will happen in the future. And the quote on the right, it's called abstract bias. Climate change is something that is seen as something really abstract. Yeah, it's something intangible. You cannot touch it. You cannot grab it, really. And that makes it difficult to believe that climate change can have severe impacts. Then about the impact, I think we can see already the impact of climate change, and this should be partially agree again. Then you can see that most kids are neutral. And then from the interviews, some kids said things like this: for me, no, I think we cannot see impact because it's more for later, for 100 years ago or so in the future. And this is called also, it's a sort of distancing. It's actually called delayed distancing, delay discounting. So it's seen for something in the future. But what do they think about? Floods, water shortages, heat waves? We don't know exactly, but Do you have some ideas about it? Or more indirect effects, decrease in biodiversity, food security, economic decline? You don't know yet exactly. Some kids, they think about maybe their personal, the things they like to do, go on skiing holiday, for example, but we don't know exactly about it. But let's have a look at the Netherlands, what will be the impact in the Netherlands. And this map shows the potential impact of climate change. And you can see in Southern Europe, the impact is generally high, but also the Netherlands, especially the western part of the Netherlands, the impact of climate change is really high. But if you look at this map, the perceived impact of climate change, then you can see that the Netherlands, just like Poland, or even lower, I think the perception about the impact of climate change in the Netherlands is the lowest in all of Europe. So while the Netherlands are greatly affected by climate change, people perceive the impact as generally low. So why is that? We can question why is that? I've got to tell you something. Flood risk in the Netherlands. In this map, you can see the dark blue area, that's the part of the country that is below sea level at this moment, but as sea levels are rising, this area, the dark blue area, will expand. It's about 20 or 25% of the country. And in blue, you can see the areas that are just above sea level, maybe 1 or 2 meters, but can still be flooded from the sea, or flooded by the rivers, because the Netherlands it's a delta country. And Amsterdam is right here at this spot. So this is the area that can be flooded. And in another survey, my colleague asked young kids in the Netherlands who live in an area that can be flooded, and actually we live in an area where the flood risks or the chance of dying by flood is higher than the chance of dying by a traffic accident. And they asked, do you think it's possible that a flood can occur in the Netherlands? And most kids agree. Do you think that a flood can occur in my own town? Then most kids disagree. So that's also this distancing bias, that they think it can happen, but it's not going to happen to me. Psychological distancing. So, and that's pretty strange, because if you looked at natural disasters, the biggest natural disaster in Europe of the 20th century was in the Netherlands. It was in the southwest of the Netherlands. There was a storm at sea. Many dikes were breached, I think more than 100 locations. The dikes collapsed and water was flowing in the area, in the inland area, and lots of villages, they were flooded, and about 2,000 people died. So it's the biggest natural disaster in the Netherlands. So all these kids, have they forgot about it? Don't they, have they never heard about it in the history books? Or so, it is in the history books. But we also should tell something else. After this flood, there was a big program was set up to make the Netherlands safer again, to raise the dikes, to make them stronger, and to build lots of dams. And this was finished in the late 1990s. And after that, our former queen, they said, well, the Netherlands is safe again now. We are protected against floods. So for many years, many decades, the Dutch government has told people in the Netherlands, you don't have to worry about flood safety. We will take care of that. And only recently they started to communicate about actual risk, and saying that we should consider that a flood can happen and that we should be prepared for that. But for many decades, they've told, you don't have to worry about flood risk, we'll take care of it. And this may be why people in the Netherlands, and also young kids, think we don't have to worry that much about climate change. And there's another thing. If you look at trust in politicians on the left, you can see, I think politicians will take enough measures to reduce climate change. And you can see that most kids are neutral. But if you compare this with trust in politicians in general, which is pretty high in the Netherlands, maybe similar as in Scandinavia, but it's trust in politicians in the Netherlands is much higher than in other countries in Europe, especially compared to Southern Europe and also to Eastern Europe. But trust that politicians can deal with climate change, it's lower than that. Yeah, most kids think we have a problem that politicians are not able to deal with climate change. And then the question, I think scientists will find ways to reduce climate change. Well, what do you see in this graph? They're really optimistic. Most kids are neutral, or they partially agree. This is partially agree again, or they fully agree. And this is called the technological fix. The idea that technology is going to save us. So many kids think technology scientists will find ways to mitigate climate change. And of course it is, it's a good thing that kids are optimistic, but maybe it's a sort of false optimism that we shouldn't rely on technology that much, because if we rely, if we think positively about technology, then that also means that we don't have to change our lifestyles. We don't have to make sure that systemic change will be achieved. So it makes them more passive, probably. And it's an easy way to think, oh, well, technology will is going to save us. Well, many scientists, they think technology can do some things to reduce climate change a little bit, but still we need to reduce our carbon footprint drastically. So my colleague also asked questions, what do you think about different measures to reduce climate change? Are they useful? And also, are you willing to do that yourself? And then you can think about different categories, green energy, recycle your garbage, or consume less products, meat consumption, and traveling by plane. But first I will talk about the Netherlands, the carbon footprint of people in the Netherlands. If you look at different aspects of what causes climate change a lot, then you can see that consumer goods has a severe contribution to climate change. And this is for the Netherlands, but it's also probably for other developed countries in the world. So it's probably for other countries in Europe, it's more or less similar. Then transport, it also has an impact of climate change, indirectly, directly via the gas, but also by constructing a production of cars, and consuming food, also especially consuming meat. So altogether, we can see that consumer goods are the largest contribution to climate change, followed by car travel and meat. But my colleague asked kids, what do you think about different measures? Will they help? Will they be useful to climate change, to reduce climate change? And are you willing to do that yourself? What about clean energy? Do you think it's useful to reduce climate change? Well, most kids think it is useful. Are you willing to buy clean energy yourself? If you have to pay more for that, then you can see the willingness to act is a bit lower. And this again should be partially agree instead of disagree. So the willingness to act is lower than the perceived usefulness. Then about recycling stuff, recycling goods. Do you think it is useful? Well, most partially agree, but the willingness to do that is again, is lower. And there are about 15% of the kids, they are not willing to recycle anything at all. Then about meat consumption, do you think it is useful? Well, then we can see a really varied response going from disagree to agree. And this also has to do something about the knowledge that they have. They don't know that meat consumption is the second most important contribution to climate change. And are you willing to eat less meat? Then you can see that still about 15% of the kids is willing to eat less meat. Well, in the Netherlands, we have quite a lot of vegetarians compared to other countries. But still, it's less than 15%. But the amount is rising steadily. And I think maybe nowadays, almost 10% of the population is vegetarian. But still, there are kids that say, don't touch my piece of beef. Don't touch my burger. I want to eat it. This is from the interviews. Read this, please. So what do we see in this this quote? Eating meat is bad, they say, but everyone eats meat. I do too. So it cannot be that bad. Well, this is another bias. It's called a cognitive dissonance. So you hear new information, but this information, it doesn't match my actual behavior. So I'm just going to ignore it. Well, and you can see that a lot. Yeah. Cognitive dissonance. It's one of my favorite psychological mechanisms. Then this one. If I stop flying, other people will still go on holiday by plane. You know, it's not fair. So why should I stop flying? Yeah. What is it in this? What kind of psychological mechanism do you see here? It's not fair. If I have to change my lifestyle, and if I have to skip all the things that make me happy, that I enjoy, well, other people are not going to do that. Now, this one is called a free rider's aversion bias, because the people that are not going to change their way of living, that's still going to enjoy eating meat, enjoy going on a holiday by airplane, they're called free riders because they do enjoy all the good things, but they also enjoy that other people have to reduce the carbon footprint and the climate change reduction made by others. And this is also why it's that bad that President Trump has withdrawn the United States from the Paris Agreement, because other countries say, well, the United States is a free rider now. We have to hurt ourselves by adapting or by reducing our carbon footprint. Well, they don't have to do that. It's not fair. So kids also feel this. And then this one, what do you think about this one? Okay, is it a psychological mechanism? Maybe it's just lack of solidarity. And we saw that sometimes, yeah. And also lack of ecological solidarity. What about biodiversity? I don't care. Some kids feel about it this way, yeah. Then how can the variance in attitude be explained? That was also investigated. The independent variables like the gender of the students was investigated, taken into account. The ethnic background, is it white or original Dutch background or from a migration background? Then the school type, vocational training or general education, pre-university education, and also geography. Geography was not included, no, because all kids were from Amsterdam. And Amsterdam, it's a diverse city, and it's also a pretty leftist city on average. So what is the influence of gender on risk perception? Well, that is pretty low, or that was not significant. And the influence of gender on the willingness to act was low. Female kids, girls were more willing to act than boys. But it was not a big influence. Then about the ethnic background, then there was some influence in the risk perception. Students from a migration background, they had a lower risk perception. And also a significantly lower, a much lower willingness to act than the white Dutch kids. I can see there's a question in the chat. Just have a look at that. Oh, no, it's something else. I'll continue. Then about the, then about the school type, I forgot about it. It did not have influence a lot. Then about the attitudes of the parents. On risk perception, it has a low influence. Students in which their parents were concerned about climate change also had a little bit higher risk perception, and especially on the willingness to act. If their parents are willingness to act, then the kids also had this. So this correlation was pretty strong. And that's, of course, very logical, because these parents, they play an important role in the development of values. They discuss values with their kids, why they think this way, what do you think, why is that? They can be examples. If their parents are vegetarians, or if their parents recycle their garbage, then they can be an example for the kids. And also they can provide knowledge about climate change. Yeah, so the influence of the attitudes of the parents, especially on the willingness to act, was pretty high. Then what about knowledge? Knowledge about the causes of climate change, it did not have effect on the risk perception and the willingness to act. Or the effect was really, really, really small. And this was measured because my colleague also did a knowledge test. Then perception about the effects of climate change, well, it has a low influence on the risk perception, it was a low correlation. And knowledge about the measures, it had a higher influence on the risk perception, and also some influence on the willingness to act. A thing is, these kids, they have little knowledge about the effects of climate change on their own lives. Because climate change at schools, it's usually taught about some other places that are affected by climate change. But that's in the lower grades in education in the Netherlands. So they don't really relate it to their own lives. And yes, this data was collected after the long and dry summer of 2018, and then climate change was a lot in the news. But still, they don't really relate it to their own lives. They're more concerned about other places. Yeah. Attitude towards the news, it didn't have any effect. There was almost no correlation. But there are some other things that we don't know about. What about general feelings of fear? Kids that are more afraid of things in general, are they? What is the effect on risk perception and willingness to act? We don't know yet. And about feelings of solidarity, how does that relate to risk perception and willingness to act? We don't know yet. No. Altogether, the variables that were taken into account could explain about half of the variance. So still half of the variance is not explained yet. But that is also because some variables, some independent variables, were not included in this research. So, altogether, which factors influence students' perceptions about climate change? Well, it depends on the location, of course, because climate change has different effects in different countries. If you look at the Mediterranean region, there are getting more heat waves there, and especially more droughts. And that's a problem in countries in the Mediterranean, like, for instance, Malta. If you look at the Netherlands, then we have sea level rise, which is a severe threat, and also increased discharges of the River Rhine, because we are a delta country. That is the problem. But in Czech Republic or Norway, climate change has other effects. So it depends on the local climate change situation. And also the education context, it influences students' perceptions. Because every country has a different curriculum with different learning goals, different content. And in the Netherlands, the curriculum, like in most countries, it's focused on knowledge and not so much about attitudes, because you cannot test it in the next national exams. And it's not focused at making sure that students change their behavior. And most, although there are lots of teachers in the Netherlands who think it is important that students do so, that they don't want to be like, how do you say, to push that much for that. So the location, the national curriculum, it influences how kids think about climate change. But then there's all this information they receive via the media, the discussion in politics, and also how their parents and friends think about climate change. And these are all sociological processes. How do you deal with all this information? And then you can also see there are lots of biases when students perceive this information. And then there are these filters in your head and all these cognitive and affective processes for filtering this information. So all these factors, they can influence how people, young people, think about climate change. Conclusions about this research. What kind of conclusions can we draw? Well, first, in the Netherlands, there's little skepticism, hardly any skepticism among young kids. They think climate change is real, but there are some things. They think it's more a global issue than a local issue. It doesn't really affect my own lives. And also, they think it's more for long-term future than for the near future. And also, then not for something that is already happening at this moment. Well, the willingness to act is low to moderate. Some kids are willing to act, but most have a moderate or low willingness to act. And it is lower than the perception about the use of it, about the effectiveness of different measures. Then the background of the kids, the knowledge they have and the feelings they have, this influences the risk perception and the willingness to. So, before we start with the discussion about the implications for education, I'd like to know if there are any questions. You can ask questions via the chat, or just ask Jirka, and then Jirka can ask it to me. And if there are no questions, then we just continue.
Hello, Tim. I'm not sure if you can hear.
Yes, I can hear you.
Oh, hey. Thank you very much for the presentation. It was really nice. I just have a question. Was the finance question not at all presented? And if so, why? Because I can imagine a lot of this willingness to act is not really willingness, but ability to pay to act.
Yes, indeed. The question was asked, are you willing to pay more for green energy? That question was asked. That was the only question that has this finance component. But I think it's also because the kids were 14 to 15 years old, and it's different, difficult for them to think about financial issues. They don't know about the budget of the government of the Netherlands. If you do this research among 18-year-olds, then you could include more questions about financial aspects, because then they can compared to other interests. Yeah. But now in this research, it was only asked for the, are you willing to pay more for green energy? Okay. Any other questions? No? Then I have a question for you. What about the implications for education? what does this mean? If you know something about how young kids think about climate change, how can we adapt our education to that? How can we connect our education to young people's perception of climate change? Please use your telephone or laptop and go to menti.com and use this code and just add some ideas about how we can connect to young people's perceptions. What should we do in our education? Should we use specific kind of resources, or should we include specific kind of tasks? Please use your smartphone and enter this code. And I'm going to the new screen, which is... Jerka, can you see the menti.com in the browser now?
Yes.
Yes, you can. Okay. I'll just wait one more minute until I can see some more ideas. Okay, let's have a look. I can see some remarks, some ideas that are about outdoor education, field courses, and showing the implications, the real life implications of climate change, and show recent examples of floods or almost floods. Yes, I think these are really good approaches, especially because it addresses the distancing bias and the delay discounting. We should show that climate change is happening right now, and it's also happening right here. And also we should make these effects of climate change more tangible to students. So there are a couple of things this outdoor education can fulfill. And water issues are the most ideal concrete effects of climate change. They are more tangible than issues like economic changes or social changes or migration. Those are more indirect effects of climate change. While water issues, you can all see the droughts. You can all see the flood risk. So these are good examples to use. But especially go outside with the kids, show them climate change is not something for the future, not something for other countries like Bangladesh, but it's happening here and now. Yeah. Someone says more experiential learning. Would you like to add something about this? I think it's a good idea.
But what I mean by experiential learning is basically related to what is being said, that you actually give students experiences outside, experiencing real factors so that it becomes more and more real to them rather than just something that that is read on in books, basically.
Okay. Yes. So they should see it. They should feel it, actually. Yes. Yeah. So go to these places and let them experience it themselves. Okay. Good. And then there are some people that say you have to talk to them and give them attention and time. And someone says here about include parental participation in education programs. And this can be about to make them aware of their own values also, and to do something with that. Yes. Not to focus on the cognitive processing of information only, or learning about climate change, but this is also learning for sustainable development. And this can help. Yes, I think good ideas. Yeah. Just have a look. Hands-on activities are said a couple of times. Yes, they should do something about work with climate change. And this could also be achieved in education. Let them look at their local environments and make plans for how can we adapt to climate change. So not only focus on mitigation, but also for your own city, which parts are vulnerable for climate change? Which parts have problems with heat, for example, or which parts of the city can be flooded? And how can we adapt our community to make it more resilient, to adapt to this climate change? And that is a good way, I think, to engage them. Yeah, it's a hands-on activity. And in the Bloom taxonomy, the pyramid with learning goals, it's on the top to create a plan to deal with these problems. Yeah. And I don't know in other countries, but in the Netherlands, people from the local community, they are always interested in connecting with education. So we can, in schools, they can always call someone from the local community who is willing to give feedback on products made by students. If they make a poster about how to design their community to make it more climate resilient, and someone from the government is always willing to provide some extra information and to give some feedback. So that's a good thing to do. Yeah. Any other people would like to add something to it? Just grab the microphone if you want to say something. I can see here. Oh, yes, please. Go ahead.
I just want to say probably not from here and nothing online.
Okay, nothing online. Okay. Just one more thing. Here on the bottom right, someone says about nature education, the importance of nature education. Yeah, I think so. That is important too, that students have a connection with nature. And that they actually feel it and see the beauty of nature. And that is also something that affects these attitudes towards nature. Yeah. And also the knowledge about the problems that nature faces, that it is important to make them more aware of climate change. And that's something that doesn't happen automatically. When we are talking about deforestation with young kids, then kids say, well, I cycle to school and there are still trees everywhere. So do we really have to worry about it? But just show them about nature and also the biodiversity and let them compare to places with a low biodiversity, for example. And say, let them show that just a tree it doesn't make a really good nature place. I see it's 11 o'clock, so we should wrap up. If there's a final question, then please go ahead. Last chance. No? Okay. Well, thank you very much for this information and these ideas about how to connect to young people's perceptions. And I hope you could use this this presentation to design education about climate change yourself. Okay. I see people clapping, but I hear no sound. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Tim. Can you hear that?
Yes.
Perfect. For everyone who is online now, we should start like